Oh, we live. Good day, guys. Welcome to IAMTHEDATA. I'm Nathaniel Evans. We focus on leadership and inner development. I have my special guest, which I actually had before, Dr. Tammy McCotter. You know, and this has been a road. When I first started doing my podcast, you know, Tammy saw me out there. She saw what I was doing. She reached out to me. And from then on, you know, I just been growing, building, been through a couple of changes. You know, I had a partner, but you know, I don't got that partner no more. You know, so, but it's, you know, at the end of the day, it's about transitioning. And when you're on your path, this is something to understand that it is an inner journey. You know, you find teams and you find groups in the world, but those groups and teams are only basically collective according to individualism. They have to have that individual spark in order to be able to create those type of teams, in order to create those type of awarenesses and knowledge-based systems. So when you talk about, the other day I was in class and I was speaking about, my professor put some videos up. It was kind of amazing. Because But you know, I'm doing my master's in political administration. And since I started doing that master's, it actually changed my whole mindset on advocacy, politics, the nonprofit industry. And the professor put up two songs. I forgot the name of them, but one song was talking about a man. It was a white man who was talking about him traveling from state to state, and a woman followed him from state to state and in search of his mystery, right? Mm-hmm. And you didn't find out until the end of the song where his mystery was. He was out there trying to find gold. Right. And he said the woman followed him. She had children. And every time he got said he couldn't find gold, they relocated and went somewhere else. And then he put a song up where a black woman was speaking, singing the song. And she was saying that she found a perfect man. She loved him. He's amazing. And then the man lost his job. And she was like, you know, if you don't find a job on Thursday, you got to leave. Uh-huh. Right. And it was so interesting because it's only me and another guy in the classroom, and it's just a swarm of just women. And, you know, the woman was like, yes, that's what I'm talking about. A man got a job. You know what I'm saying? He got to leave. He got to get out of here, right? And I was like, okay. And I was like, well, is that the only essence of a man at economics? And it was like the Bible said a man and woman must be equally yoked. And I was like, really? I said, so can you show me that scripture? Because I read the Bible. I didn't see that one yet. And it was like the scripture basically saying that if one is righteous and the other one is unrighteous, then they cannot walk together. It didn't say about one person have more finances than the other person that they cannot walk together, because it's impossible I'm going to have the same finances that my partner going to have or vice versa. And it was just really clear to show like the divisions that take place in this life, even when you're in relationships with people, even when you're trying to build systems with people, are not always equally yoked, because we're not equally yoked in all things, right? We may have the same concept of like, you know, let's go to school together, or let's study this together, or let's do that together. But it's other things about us that's different that people don't know about us. And some of these things we don't even share. But I don't want to take up too much time, guys. I actually want to introduce Tammy Speaks, powerful, powerful young lady. And she has a lot to offer, a lot to teach us in the world. And we could come back to this video 100 years from now. You know, I won't be here, but you know, and I actually learned a few things from Tammy, you know. And with that, you got the floor, Tammy. Just introduce yourself. Let's have a conversation.
Well, thank you so much. I enjoy being on your podcast because it's a conversation, you know, and I really believe that authentic conversation, not rehearsed conversation, but authentic conversation will touch the lives of the listeners. It'll be exactly what they need to hear when they need to hear it. And those that are supposed to hear it will be here to hear it. So I'm just honored to be here. I am an author, I am a life coach, but most of all, I am a person that believes in reconnecting the returning citizen to purpose. And I know that when I say that, a lot of people automatically, their mind goes to incarcerated people. But the truth of the matter is you have people that are walking around free, or what we see or what we understand to be freedom, and they're bound and they're not connected to understand who they are and what their purpose is. And my purpose in life is to reconnect them to their purpose. So
I agree with that. I agree with that 100%. I believe that, you know, when we look at that, they say the prison system is like a basically high manifestation of bondage that you can actually look and say, look what he's at, look what she's at, look what they did. But it's other people, like when they talk about Jeffrey Dahmer and people like that, that was actually doing crime for years, right? And they never got caught, right? And other people like Jack the Ripper, that they never even found who Jack the Ripper was, right? Mm-hmm. That actually did things in society, was bound by certain things in society that we don't look at. When we see the person sleeping on the train or sleeping in the streets or sleeping inside the train station or on a bus, we got to ask ourselves what bondage has found them in the world to lock them out of their space of existence, right?
I think a lot of times what people don't understand is that the most powerful thing that you have, that you've been created with, is your mind. Mm. And the truth is, most people don't even use a quarter of their mind. They're programmed. They are told what their limitations are. They're given a description of what they can achieve, who they can be, and what they can have. And it starts at an early age sometimes. And those are the things that I go after when I seek to bring and reconnect people to their purpose, because there is nothing no stronger than a made up mind. And if you can see it and you can believe that you can have it, I didn't say you can believe it, because you got a lot of people believing stuff, but they don't believe that it can happen for them. If you can see it and you can believe that you can have it, there is absolutely nothing that you cannot do. But most of the time people see it, they don't believe that they can do it, and they're wanting something that is not within the purpose for them, and they get frustrated when they don't achieve it. You know, but you can accomplish anything you want in life if you truly believe it. Mm. If you truly believe it for yourself.
For yourself. It goes back to what I was talking about earlier, individualism, right? We have a collective society where, you know, when I was in the streets when I was younger, as a young man, it was things that I saw that I said, you know what, I'm not doing certain things, right? You know, I would see like 10 of my friends got the same hoodie on, right? Or the same sneakers. So I was like, no, I'm not buying that. I'm not trying to be this common person, you know, that's in the world. And we're easily conformed to certain things, because who want to be viewed as an outsider? Who want to be viewed as a person, you know, they're not a part of the club, you know, they don't get our message, you know, they don't understand what we're trying to do here. You know, when I go into spaces of harm, like closed Rikers Island campaigns, I was at one like 2 days ago, it was like 100 people out there. You had politicians, you had teachers, you had pastors, chaplains. Yeah, just everyday citizens in the world that people don't know, but they about, you know, they have their own identities, but we don't know about them. They just pop up and finally see what's going on. You got the news. And why is this taking place? Because men and women are losing their lives in a place that's supposed to be about redemption. Mm-hmm. It's supposed to be about healing the mind, the heart, the soul. You know, reintroducing them back to the spirit of who they are, right? We get lost in all these different things where man creates this or man, woman creates that, and say, well, you're subject to this and you're subject to that. And once you start going into yourself, you realize that I'm not bound by anything. Like, I'm not really controlled by these things that they have created. Like, this is, what are they talking about? This is a mystery that a man has created a system to bow me. When he was free, he was born free in the same manner that I was born free. But we get into systems and you go into cultures all over the world and, you know, we're dealing with wars and disagreements about these things or that thing, and life is being lost on all sides. But it's not just life, you know, it's visions, it's goals, it's hope, it's faith. These are the things that's being lost. It's not just life. It's people that had higher aspirations to do greater things in the world, or had things in place to do things for the world, and they no longer here. And now we got to restart. We got to wait for a whole new generation or new, basically essence of spirits to come into the world to pick up those pieces that was left behind, to start this process all over again, to ensure that we find ourselves on a higher plateau of humanity.
Well, this is where I kind of disagree in just a little bit, and I'm going to tell you why. You said something that was so powerful, and you're absolutely correct. You know, in the initial intention with corrections or prisons, it was given the title rehabilitation. That's what the ultimate goal was supposed to be. However, it took on that name, but nobody knew the structure that was needed, the process that was needed to rehabilitate. Rehabilitation, if you break that word down, it means to rebuild. You could not and you cannot rebuild something if the foundation for which it was supposed to be built on was never there. So I said that to say this: you had a lot of people that came into incarceration that did not know who they were. They came in and they were 100% kings and queens when they came in, but they didn't know that. And come into a system that you want the responsibility of the system to rebuild something on a foundation that is not already there. That's where the disconnect is when it comes to incarceration. I feel like now that a lot of formerly incarcerated people are standing up and they're lifting their voices. And they're going back and they're saying, listen, you can make it, because they found their foundation. Whether they struggled to do it, whether someone helped them to do it, they are doing it. And I feel personally that was something that was always missing, because I could go in there, and I did for many a years, and I would say, you better than that. That's not who you are. Your present position is not an indication of your future potential. Pull your pants up, young man, and walk like a king. Hold your head up. What you saying that for, Miss Mac? I'm saying what I see. What I'm going to do that for, Miss Mac? I'm incarcerated, because that's not who you are. It's just where you're at. Now, I can say that all day long, not having been a person that was incarcerated physically. But when they see someone that has the same track record that they had, and they too themselves felt like they couldn't get up, but they got up, dust themselves off, and now they're millionaires, billionaires, trillionaires, whatever. They're a host of shows, they're owning businesses. They're teaching, getting degrees. And when they go back and they get into the mindset of that person, because the only thing, the difference between someone that is physically incarcerated, someone that is free that is incarcerated, and the one that is not bound, is the mindset. And we want to go after everything else and dodge that bullet. until we teach people how to train and change, train their mind and change their mind, we're going to continue to repeat this cycle.
Yeah, and imagine this, and then this is an amazing cycle right here, right? Because this topic today is Unshakable Optimism, the Impactful Life of Tammy McCotter, right? And when you look at what she's saying about revisiting this process, right? So imagine that we are instructed to come down here and do certain things, right? And do our path as we're moving, you know, we don't really get involved with the full process of that change, right? And let's say, you know, we become multimillionaires, we have properties, we have different things of that nature. And imagine, you know, when our time, you know, for transitioning takes place, that we up there, we chilling now, you know, we eating the food of the gods and walking on pavements of gold and diamonds and silver that you're talking about in Revelations, right? That the Most High come and tap us on the shoulder and say, you know what, bro, I see you chilling and stuff. Everything is good up here, bro. But you ain't finished your assignment when you was down there. I need you to go back down there and finish your assignment. And you're going to be like, no way, bro. Like, that place down there is crazy. Like, the stuff they doing down there and what's going on down there, bro, I'm not trying to be a part of that. And he said, no. You agreed to this assignment beforehand. You went down there. You got lost in the source. You didn't align your mind with your heart and your spirit to do the work you're supposed to do when you came down here. And because you didn't do that work is unfinished. And look at what's happening because you didn't finish that work. I need you to go back down there and finish that work. How would you feel about it then? If you knew that this was basically a consequence, this was an accountability for you, what would you do differently if you was in these type of systems? If you was in places where harm was being perpetuated, and you had the tools and the resources and the heart and the mind to change it, but then you said, you know what I'm saying, I'm not going to do it because these people are beneath me, or because, you know, I'm only here to make money and do certain things. How would you feel if you have to do that assignment all over again?
Well, I give you one better than that. What about your own neighborhood? You see that young man, that young lady, what about that young girl that's in that grocery store that's got the little child running behind her and the child is crying and she's at her wit's end trying to pay for $2 worth of whatever? Is it not your responsibility to help, to speak wisdom, to show love? You may not have whatever, but at least you can go over and give her a word of kindness, a word of encouragement. See, we want to jump on what we call the big causes and look over and skip over the fact that it's the small things that make the changes. Big crimes don't become big crimes. They start out small.
Gateways.
Absolutely. People that walk in, I'll give you an example. I love doing my lives when I come on in the morning. That's something that I'm passionate about. It is something that I truly believe that God gave me to do. I really do. I don't really look for the feedback because I know that it's a mission in life for me. When I first started, I used to get in my inbox, this is a professional site. Don't do that up here. This is not the platform for that. Go to Facebook, go to Instagram. I would never respond. I never once responded. I just kept doing my videos. I remember one time that I was at a conference or something and I wasn't able to post for like 2 or 3 days because we were in conference and whatever. And all of these people were inboxing me. CEOs, business owners, police officers, lawyers. Good morning. Hope you have an amazing day. Just checking on you. Never once comment on my posts, but they're watching. I said that to say this. When it comes to mission and purpose and fulfilling that purpose, you got to start where you are. You can't worry about how big the table is. You just need to make sure that your seat is at that table.
That's correct.
If I had not been in place and did these videos to encourage people, you don't even understand some of the messages that I get in my inbox on LinkedIn. Thank you, Miss McCotter. Thank you, Dr. McCotter. I was going through divorce and I somehow your post came across my feed today and it gave me the encouragement to hold my head up. Thank you. I was praying and seeking for an answer. And this morning you had my word. I don't know what I'm going to say most of the time, but I endeavored, number one, to make a difference. Number two, to walk in purpose. And number three, not worry about the accolades, the attaboys, none of that. I do it because I know that that's my purpose in life. And that's how you have to combat what we're fighting in society today, what we're fighting in the prison system, what we're fighting in our neighborhoods. We got to start where we are with who's in front of us at that time, because you'll never reach the larger until you can manage and reach the smaller version of it. And your impact can change that person's life. And then it'll spread like wildfire. Because it becomes authentic. It's the core of who you are. It's not what you're doing. It is who you are.
Yeah, I think so. I think that, you know, it definitely comes down to being exactly who you are. This world does have a lot of influences, a lot of coercion, manipulations and stuff like that. And can move people out of their path. You know, that's basically why I created this podcast. To show people that yes, I am the data, we are the data, we are the data of our change. It starts with us, it's about who we are. And you know, I said, well, what about the collective? The collective is us. We're part of that whole spectrum. But if the individual chain that you create for the bike, that one individual chain pops, even though it's a part of the collective, everything shatters. Next thing you know, you flying off the bike. You're in the middle of traffic. You're like, please don't hit me, right? And it's like, you know, because you're not paying attention that one little link. It was an individual, a part of a collective whole. And when that link, if that link shatters, or that link pops, which is you, that collective whole that you're a part of, it also shatters as well. Your friends, your family, your coworkers, and also basically condolences to you as well. And one of your coworkers passed away the other day that I saw that, you know, and I want to commend you, you know, for, you know, putting him out there, speaking about his life, his journey, and, you know, and the losses that he experienced. He was married, he had children. And, you know, as men, we look at systems and try to define one another according to systems of what we do and what we don't do. A man reached out to me the other day in my inbox. And was like, I, you know, come to one of my events. And I was like, yeah. So I looked at the event and I seen that the event was a paid event, you know. And I was like, well, you know, I didn't reach out to him to come to the event. He reached out to me to come to the event, but now I got to pay for the event. So I said, you know, instead of me just saying no, let me reach back out and say, you know, do you have a sponsor? Because I seen he had like a sponsor component there. So I said, do you got a sponsor for this event? And he was like, I don't understand. Are you trying to sponsor somebody or do you need to be sponsored? And I said, well, you know, I need to be sponsored, you know? And I never heard another thing after that. It was like straight silence. And I'm like, you know, you'll see what I'm doing. You'll see the work that I'm doing. And you're like, all right, let me see how I can pull from this individual instead of cultivate me. If you have a space where you can cultivate me and build me, then that's a great thing, because I'm gonna tell you something, man. Everything come back full circle. So it may be in a space on 5 years from now, 10 years from now, where I may see you and say, oh man, I remember that brother. I remember that sister. They actually helped me out when I was doing certain things. They actually gave me knowledge and wisdom. You know what I'm saying? They actually, you know, came on my podcast and supported, you know what I'm saying, the growth of my system so I could actually build and reach other people. And I said, I remember that person. Let me reach back out to that person, you know what I'm saying, as that collective whole, you know what I mean, and bring them back, you know what I'm saying, to the link. You know what I'm saying? So we can continue to do the things that we need to do as men. You know, the collective concept that in within the collective fold, you'll see that I'm greater than you type of concepts, right? And there's no greatness, right? We are all on this journey to understand life. And our connectiveness is important. It's like if you, like for instance, you go and kill all the bees in the world. We messed up. You say you're greater than the bee. But if you harm the bees, we're messed up, bro. Not only are we not gonna have no honey, but we got no insect that's gonna pollinate, you know, basically pollinate the other trees, or pollinate the plants, so we can actually have fruits and vegetables and things like that that we say that we need as a vegetarian or dietitian or things of that nature. That little bee is as great in life as you are. Well, we put ourselves on these higher plateaus. We can't see what's basically there as a part of our whole. We can't increase what we can't see. And that's what you were saying before. You have systems that say rehabilitation without understanding the essence of what they're trying to rehabilitate. When I was in Department of Corrections, I was reading a concept and they were talking about habilitation. And habilitation is basically a person does not know or ever will know basically how to basically reframe the fragments of their lives to and bring them back to a higher plateau. And when you see things of this nature, you know that we don't have the faith that we need for humanity to prosper, to thrive, and to come through unforeseen forces. We don't know what's going on. This is why we're here, to actually find out certain things that is going on.
You know, I gotta go back to the word rehabilitation. Rehabilitation means to rebuild. And you cannot build on a foundation that is not there. A lot, if in my course of having to have dealt with formerly incarcerated and incarcerated individuals, I love to ask questions. And one of the number one questions I would always ask is, what was your reason? What was your why? And I've heard many different explanations of how and why and what happened as to this turn of events in that person's life. But the number one collective that seemed to be to resonate with everyone was, I wanted to mask the pain, the hurt, whether they did it through drugs, whether robbery was assisted because they needed to get the money for the drugs, whether they did it through abuse because they were abused. It was always masking something else. And how can you expect someone to rehabilitate or rebuild when there is not a foundation there? You have to go in and lay that foundational work, plow up those roots and those weeds that have grown for so many years, that have deep roots in them, that have strangled out every ounce of belief that it is something better, and then go in and plant and then water and cultivate that mindset, that ideal, that hope, that love, that grace for that person's life. That's the way that rehabilitation starts. And I can honestly say it's happening. I want to say it like this. There, I had the opportunity to go on one of the prison tours with Mr. Cardell Sims, the behind the wall reentry. And what impressed me, what impressed me the most is that I know that the majority of these tours that he is doing and the team that he has assembled, and I'm grateful to be a part of the team whenever I can, he does it out of his pocket. Nobody pays him to do it. You know why? Because it's his passion. He wants to serve. That's when you know it's taking root. It's breaking up that fallow ground. It's going in and it's turning the normal systems upside down, and it's causing change. Grown men and grown women behind that wall breaking down and crying and saying, thank you. Somebody cares. You came back. I can only imagine that for him and all of the team that put their time aside, saved their finances up so that they can travel, all the letters that he sent out and said, I can come to your facility. Let me come and do this. I'll do it on my own dime, even when they can pay. Even when they could offer something, yet he still goes. And the lives, I saw it for myself. I'm not telling you what I read. I'm not telling you what I heard. I saw it for myself. Mm. The incarcerated individuals were saying, my God, somebody cares. You teaching them vision boarding, how to go back and change your mind by looking at a vision and saying what you see on that board, that it can be yours. You're teaching them finances, how to get your credit right, how to go back and clean your credit up. You're teaching them educational resources while telling them about your story and your journey with no apologeticness about it. That yes, I was a felon. Yes, I made mistakes. This is what rehabilitation looks like.
Yeah, you know, it's stripping the veil. It's stripping the veil, man. You know, it's actually moving in real time and real spirit, and understand that there is no utopia for life. You know what I'm saying? We cannot hide behind the past. We cannot hide behind the shadows of what life posts and tell. Life is gonna be what it's being, and that's what it is. We wanna be able to say, listen, this is a part of life, this is a part of life, and this is a part of life as well. I went through this passageway, I went through this portal, I came out this way, I came out that way, and to show that, you know what? I'm not the only one. I'm not the only one. It's just like when Christ opened that portal up. He said, he that believes, follow me. And he walked through that portal. And other people were standing there like, yo, bro, I do believe, but I don't even know if I want to walk through the portal, because I don't know what's on the other side of that portal, right? And when you coming into self-awareness, and when you coming into changing your life, that's that portal for your life that you're shooken, man. You know what I mean? You're afraid, right? You're scared. You don't know what's on the other side, because you never been on that other side. Even if it's you, when you come into a new understanding, a new psyche, you're afraid of that psyche. You're saying no, because I don't know what I'm going to become. I don't know who's going to be there for me in this new time, and who's going to drop off, and who's going to attach themselves to me, and things of that nature. But this is where the healing process begins at. This is where that cure that you need for your soul, for your ability to transition lies at, is actually taking a deep look into the dark, man. And that dark is you. Like, really, like, writing it out, singing it, you know what I'm saying? Dancing it, right? You know, screaming it out, right? Because this is purposeful. this is a very, very important dynamic for your life, right? And I know you want to come in, you know, but as you transition, it's like, you know, how do I get there, right? And how do I be at peace with who I'm becoming, what I'm becoming, what do I stand on? What does that peace that I stand on, and what does it look like for my life?
I'm telling you, you transition this thing beautiful, because that's what I was just getting ready to say. You know, the reason why, and I'm not trying to do a shameless plug, but I have to say this. The reason why I wrote the first book, that you are a designer's original. Your unique identifier gives you access, is because of that. What you just spoke of, because most people do not understand, do not know, they are not aware of the fact that they have a purpose. Especially people that are disconnected. You ask a person, matter of fact, I'll ask you, who are you? Who are you, Mr. Evans?
Who am I?
Who are you?
I am that I am, you know. I'm a leader in my life, you know. I'm a man that loves life, you know, that cherishes life, you know, and strive to improve, you know what I mean? Not just the quality of my life, but also the quality of others. You know, I'm a manifestation of life itself with, you know, connecting with others, you know, finding my purpose, not just within me, but also in the grand scheme of things, is how I actually see my life.
And I'm glad that you answered, because usually when I ask people, they don't know who they are. You ask them, who are they? They will tell you what they do. That's not who you are. You are the express love of God, point blank, period. And most people do not understand that. This is why I wrote this book, because when you understand that you are a designer's original and there is nobody like you, you are so in the mind of
God. Okay,
that he gave you something to identify you by that nobody else has. Your fingerprint. Out of the millions and trillions and billions of people that have been on this earth, before you, after you, nobody fingerprint has
and with
ever,
you
ever, and with you and with you has ever been repeated. That's how much.
Say that again.
Nobody before you, nobody after you, all of the zillions of trillions of billions of people, and nobody present has your fingerprint. There's not one duplicate ever. You mean to tell me that the Creator created you so divinely that if you put your fingerprint down and I put my fingerprint down, that I can be identified different from you, and you want to be
the Creator.
You can be a carbon copy. He didn't create to be a carbon copy. That's why I wrote the book, because you have people that do not, that is your purpose in life, to discover who you are, what you were created to be, who you were created to be, that you are a masterpiece, divinely created, not by chance, but by choice. You weren't created by chance just because your mama met your daddy. That's not why you were created. It was
On a very secular level. That's on a secular level. We're biased that, you know, because now you can say, look, our fingerprints are totally different, but it's something else that's different too. Our spirits.
We all come from one spirit. And that is the spirit of God. But we don't understand who he created us to be.
And this is what we're here for. We have to understand what the nature is. Disalignment. What is this alignment about? Like what is this whole process about? Like why would an entity, you gotta ask yourself a question, why would an entity take its time and energy to create you? Like what does this entity have, you know what I'm saying, that you can give to that entity for actually creating this essence of you, who you are? What can you repay this entity?
That man, when I say man, I mean humanity, that man is the only being that God created, number one, with his own will. And even God said, I will not transgress against a person's will. You tie his hands. He wanted a family, so he created us. That's love. And we walk away from that purpose every day. We walk away, we want to hate, we want to judge, we want to distance ourselves because this one doesn't look like this one, or this one doesn't act like this one, or that one don't live at 90210 and drive a Rolls Royce, when we all are created in one person's likeness. Mm. Filled to the utmost with love and full of purpose. And that's what we are missing. That's when we miss that part, that's when we divert off and we become whatever we're called. We become, you're poor. Okay, I'm poor. You're nothing. Okay, I'm nothing. Because you don't understand who you are. And when you do, it's not what you called, it's what you answer to.
That's right.
And when you find and discover who you are, you don't answer to everything you called.
That's right. That's right. And you're not accountable. You're not accountable to answer all those things and to find yourself into those things that put you in a nice little box. You know, when you're in this world right here, people have created boxes for you, right? And they want you to just sit into that little box that they created for you. But it's like, you know what, man, that box has so many different openings to it that you can't cover all those different openings to that box. So I'm going to bust off on the side, I'm going to bust off on the top, I'm going to bust off on the bottom, right? We're going to find a way to come outside this box because, you know, I had this conversation with somebody in the past and it was basically, you know, I may have had certain, let's say, belief systems in the past. I may have certain values in the past. I may have certain, you know, insights in the past. And I say, you know, I have to apologize to you because I'm no longer of that individual. Mm-hmm. I don't believe like that individual no more. I don't have those same belief systems, those same mannerisms. I don't have that same knowledge and same goals. So if you lock me into being this individual, I apologize because I'm coming out of that space. I'm here to transition and move past even the things I created for myself. Mm-hmm. So how would I allow you to create a reality for me when you're not me? I have to create my own reality and even break through those realities I created against me. Because anything that I attach myself to, like we said, who are you, Nathaniel? I could say, you know what? I'm a advocate. You know, I'm a nonprofit professional. You know what I mean? I'm a person. I'm a reentry specialist. I'm a formerly incarcerated person. I could have came up with all these weird labels. But once I put this label on me, not only did I attach it to me, but I allow others to attach the label to me as well. And they're not going to allow me to freely transition out of this space. They're going to keep me locked into this box that I created for myself first and foremost. They came and put the wrapping on it, put the little bow on it, and threw it in the corner, right? And at the end of the day, I'm like, you know what? I can't be in no box. I'm undefined. I'm unfiltered in all my ways. And even though I may have stumbled and fallen and fell into this ditch, what did the Most High says? He said, a righteous man falleth 7 times and get back up, right? And what did Christ say about seven? He said seven times, seven times, seven times, seven. It is infinite. He's telling you the fall of a man is infinite as his rise. No man is subjected to the fall of anything in this world. Men have created false concepts of the fall. It is impossible that we have created false concepts of the fall when we're talking about King David, when we're talking about Solomon, when we got statues in the world that represent Martin Luther King and all these different men that have fallen and then rise to greatness. You know what I'm saying? Only when you say they fall, they rise into your bookshelf. You got to go read their book now. Their lives are still here letting us know, yo, bro, the fall is inevitable, but also is the rise. And if we see these things in real time, and we take away the basically the pessimism that's been attached to the fall, we can rise out of it. But if we lock ourselves into that fall, we can't go nowhere.
But the only way to take away that is people have to understand their purpose.
That's right.
To understand that they are created in love. They have to understand and get back to the root of why and who they were created to be.
The root.
I don't care how much philosophy, knowledge, whatever comes, because all those things will pass away. Faith, hope, and love, but the greater of the three is love. And if you take a bird's eye view into society today as a whole, I mean worldwide, what is the number one thing that you're noticing? Is the lack of love.
That's right.
The love is waxing cold across
The world.
Neighbors used to stand in the yard and wave at you and speak, and now people would rather be on their phones like this rather than to make eye contact and speak.
Yeah.
If we think everything that was old is new and everything that is new was once old, if we would go back to the basic being love, we could really change some things. We can make an indelible difference. The reason why I resonate with a lot of people and they watch my videos, even though they don't comment, but I see the analytics and sometimes it's 2,000 and 3,000 hits a day, is because they know it's authentic and it comes from a place of love. That's how you revolutionize and change things. It's not for our well-speaking. It is not for our education and our degrees. Those things are nice to have. It's not for our money, our affiliations, who we know, where we go, what we have. It's love.
Yeah, those things help us build on the concept of love, right? If you go and do a social degree, a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, or do any type of training, those things was created under the constitution of love, where individuals said, I have a knowledge and I can share it with others, right? And this knowledge increases throughout the land and increases from generations to centuries to centuries to ensure that we have a higher ability to actually see life on a higher level and to connect each other. It's like the Most High, he shows you in the scriptures that when you have a certain ability, like Samson, you're accountable to free your people. You're accountable to walk that thin line that others cannot walk because they don't know how to tight walk. You do. You learn how to tight walk, right? So because you learned this, you got to be the one that walk across that line. You can't say God's come with me so they can fall to their death, right? No, you got to take that. You are accountable because you went and said, I'm going to get a master in public administration. For what reason? Just so you can put it on your wall, right? Or are you getting it so you can bring forth change in the land? Today, I was outside. A friend of mine said, yo, you know, I got some stuff you want to look at. I said, I'll look at it for you. And there's another guy came. And he called him too. And the guy was like, all right, hold on, let me see what you got. I said, yo, you can come. You know, we all here together. And the man would not come next to me. The man said, nah. He don't even know me. He never even met me in his life, but he don't want to know me.
But you know,
he don't want to come in a circle.
But you know what? It still goes back to love.
That's what I'm saying. That's a loving embrace.
Let me tell you something. By loving kindness, do you draw people?
That's right.
There are doors. I'm telling you, I'm not telling you what I'm heard. I'm telling you what I know. There are doors that have opened for me, not because I knew people. I ain't know nobody. Let me say it in my vernacular. I ain't know nobody. I love saying it in my North Carolina vernacular.
That's why I ain't know nobody.
But I went in and I spoke from my heart.
Mm.
And I gave from my heart. And you would have thought that the president of the United States or Russia, whoever behind ... came into that room, that an ambassador walked into that room, because it resonated, because I did it out of love. I'm only saying that because of this. When you walk in purpose, you will not fit in with most people. I've never been one that tried to fit in with anybody. I've always been one that beat to my own drum. Anybody that I ever worked with, they'll tell you, good morning. You tired? No, I feel wonderful. I feel blessed today. I've always beat to my own drum. Has that made me popular? Absolutely not. Has that made me, you know, whatever behind ... Probably. I never cared, because it was never about me. It was always about fulfilling the purpose. And believe this or not, even if they don't like it, they will respect it. So it's not that the like that you want, they're going to respect the move, because you're making differences. That's what
right. Yeah. And then you tapping in a lot of times, like even when I used to be in the spaces and I used to be going out of corridors, I used to be singing and stuff. And men would come to me and say, what are you singing for? You in prison. I said, no, I'm not. And they're like, what are you talking about? I said, listen, man, I'm within me. Mm-hmm. I resonate within me. This is who I am. No man can identify me and put me. He can put me in any place he wants to in the world, but you won't be able to identify me. You won't take the spirit or the original unique fingerprints that the Most High gave to me for my spirit and account it to you. You won't. I'm not going to allow you to do it. Right? At the end of the day, I'm going to walk according to my purpose. You're not going to put a minefield in front of me and let me see it and think I'm going to step on it, because I'm not. I'm going to jump over it, dive over it, whatever I got to do. But I'm not going to allow you to structure my steps and to move me in the spaces of your comfortability, for you can actually do the things that you need to do in your existence, but deny me mine.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and it's so... It's such a passion of mine. It really is. I love, absolutely love, loving on people. Mm. I absolutely love loving on people, because for me, love truly transformed my life. It filled me to overflowing. So I'm not giving something that I don't have. I'm giving of my excess. I'm giving from the overflow. I intentionally give love, even to people that don't want it. I do it on purpose.
Yeah.
Because the one thing that I know beyond the shadow of a doubt is, even if it doesn't transform them right then, it touches them and they never get it.
You planting seeds, you know. And as you planting seeds, you don't know when they're going to grow. But one day you're going to walk by and say, yo, I can grab me a banana off that tree, man. Right? I'm hungry right now. Who put that banana tree there? Who put that apple tree there? These are the things of abundancy that used to be in our lands on a high level instead of going to supermarkets and things of that nature. But we could plant the seeds within one another now.
Yeah.
You might have taken these things out of the land, but you have not taken these things out of us. We still have the propensity, the accountability, and the love to basically initiate each other to find new hope, to find new life, and to have new purpose in our paths. Right? I'm here to guide you as you are here to guide me. I'm not greater than you, and God most high forbid that you're greater than me. Right? We are here to cultivate each other to take us to that whole new plateau. Right? We got a few minutes left, you know, and listen, man, look at this video, you know, look at this podcast. Reach out to Tammy, reach out to me. Let's have a conversation like we always do. Tammy has books on Amazon. You can basically find them. And these books is just, like she said, is about find that love. And this is where the unshakable optimism comes from. If you want to know, it comes from love. This is why she's able to go into dark spaces and basically have that radiancy of her life. Why she's able to touch people as she's coming down the corridor and say, who is she? Where did she come from, right? Who is he? Where did he come from? Because we're here to represent life. We're not here to represent death. We're not here to represent harm. We're here to cure one another from the things that actually been a part of this world. Like I said, if you had to come back down here on another assignment because you ain't finished this assignment, how would you feel about it? What would you say to the most high? You say, yo, man, you know, I let you chill up here for like 5 years, you know what I'm saying? And now it's time for you to go back down there and finish up what you did. And you're going to be like, yo, but I thought that I was just here to get some houses, some cars, you know what I mean, to find a special man, a special woman. Say, no. Yeah, something was greater than that, right? It's about tapping back into who we are. What is our assignment? Who are you, as actually Tammy said to me, who am I, right? And locking ourselves in. But also what I've seen from IAMTHEDATA, we are accountable to one another. You can say that you are this great man. You can speak about wealth. You can speak about power. But at the essence of it, our Lord created us in love. Because he tells us in Joshua, he said, when I found you, you was naked. You was full of blood. You know what I'm saying? And I came and I cleaned you up. I clothed you. I gave you food and drink. You know what I'm saying? And I called you my own. Right, there's nothing greater than that. You know, we're fearful of men, you know, and women when we see them in despicable places. But yeah, we may see them in despicable places on a physical level. But who sees us in a despicable place on a spiritual level? We hide our spiritual harms. We hide the things that we're going through. We put the whole world on our shoulder, you know, but we don't have to. There are ways to escape the things that we even have done to ourselves. There are ways to create new purposes in our lives. And Tammy gonna show you this. She talks about this all the time. Look at her YouTube pages, look at her Instagram. Go on Amazon and find her. And then put her on your podcast. You gotta have a conversation. Because this is I was on a Zoom the other day and a man was saying something about the work that he was doing. And I said, you know, sir, you know, I need to say something to you, sir. This has nothing to do with you. This is greater than you, sir. We're doing this for the next few centuries that's going to come down here. If this issue still exists, those that come behind us can actually finish the framework that you have created in the name of love to dismantle systems of harm so we can be at peace on our spiritual rest and don't have to come back down here to do this thing all over again. That's how I look at it. You know, say a few words, Tammy, let them know, connect with you, how to connect with you, and then we're going to sign off.
Okay. Well, let me say it's been a pleasure, as always, coming on here and just having a conversation. I love conversation. But my ultimate goal and desire, if I could be so blunt, is that I desire to get both of these books, this one and this one, in the prison systems and the schoolhouses.
Let's do it.
This one, because it tells you about your purpose, who you are, and who you were created to be. And this one, because it tells you how to maintain that lifestyle and live on purpose 365 days out of the year and twice on Sunday.
That's right.
Because after you learn who you are, you must learn the skill of how to maintain it. So I am so grateful. I pray that whoever listens to this podcast, that you will go and you will purchase these books for someone, maybe yourself, someone that's incarcerated, someone that's struggling, a single parent, a single dad, someone that is dealing with identity crisis, so that they will know who they are. Sow it to them in love. Not because you're making my pockets fat. No, you're not. But because you're transforming their lives. Be a part of the solution and not the problem. That's you can find me on Amazon.com as Dr. Tammy McCotter. You can find me on LinkedIn.
It's right there. The book is right there.
Yes, that is the name of one of the books, and the other one is the You Are a Designer's Original. Your unique identifier gives you access, but if you pull up that one, you can pull up both of them. I'm also on LinkedIn as Dr. Tammy McCotter. I'm on Instagram as Dr._Tammy_Speaks. On Facebook as Tammy McCotter. And on YouTube as @DrTammySpeaks.
So we got we found each other on YouTube. Maybe yeah. I gotta make sure. We gotta make sure. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? But I definitely love to help you with that project. That's an amazing thing right there. You know, and that's you know, like I said, let's have a conversation. And that's actually let's build. You know, don't go off right now.
I am getting in the prisons. I just came from Eastern Correctional in Westover, Maryland. And I spoke there to over 85 people. So the doors are opening slowly, but it's happening.
But it's happening. That's right. That's right. That's right. Help Tammy on this journey. She can reach more people, you know what I'm saying, with our assistance, you know what I mean, with our love, our pouring of our love. Yeah. And this is what this is about. This is what it's about. With that, guys, happy to be here, you know, every Sunday at 2 p.m. Had a little mix it with the times, but that's not my fault. It's these systems in certain ways. But I'm going to continue to do my path. I'm going to continue to do my purpose. I'm going to continue to be I am the data. I am that I am, right?
Absolutely. And with that,
that's right. Please subscribe. Please connect with Tammy. You don't know how to find her, you can find me, and I help you find her. You know what I'm saying? This is how we do this thing, right?
Yeah. Oh, and I wanted to say, don't leave the boardroom out, because from the CEO to the lawyer, from the doctor to the nurse, needs to understand their purpose.
That's right. That's right. That's right. With that, guys, please subscribe, help me connect, and be on a higher plane. Don't leave yet, Tammy.